live stream, so I want to send a special shout out to the people on Waimiki and Great Barrier who may be watching tonight. This is for you as well. Let me say that I'm very honored to be speaking to you tonight, and I appreciate the invitation. And I hope that by the end of my presentation, which will be 45, 50 minutes or so, you'll understand why I decided to go with a fairly provocative title for this talk. And I put as my main slide image a fanciful interpretation of the question. So I just want to start out by saying, of course, this is not exactly what I have in mind, but that we could get close to this. And that's maybe the interesting outcome here. So since we're going on a brief journey together, I want to tell you where we're going to go. I want to start on the large scale with the issue of light pollution and how it impacts a lot of things besides the ability to see the night sky, and then kind of gradually drop down a little bit more to the level of a crowd of people who are near and dear to my heart, which is the amateur astronomy community I came from and still involved with in the States. So I'm going to try to give you a convincing argument as to why you should care about the issue of light pollution beyond your ability to see the night sky, even though I will agree with you that that's an important aspirational goal. I'm going to then narrow down a little bit further to New Zealand and tell you about why I think this country is really quite far ahead of most others in the world in terms of preserving its dark skies, but also that there are some challenges that we're facing right now that are potentially very difficult, but at the same time, we know what the solutions are, so I'm going to try to come in behind the problems with the solutions and convince you that this is ultimately an easy problem to solve if we decide as a society and as a species that we want to solve the problem. And lastly, I'm going to give you a few specifics about what the future of the Auckland area might look like if we delivered on some of these solutions. Could we make things better here? And I would submit to you that the answer to that question is yes. So by the time we're done, hopefully you'll come away convinced that I've made all of these arguments in a sensible way. So let's start with as we say in America, the 10,000 foot view of the problem. And in order to frame up the problem for you, I'm going to start with a definition. And the reason I'm going to start with a definition is that the slide here has a lot of elements of what I would consider light pollution, but generally the public thinks that light pollution equals sky glow, and that's the phenomenon that you can see in the background here, that the clouds are amplifying in this case. So light from the city going up into the night sky, some of it escapes the atmosphere completely, a large fraction of it comes back down to the ground, however, and appears as kind of a fog, and that's what obscures the view of the stars. Again, the clouds are making this worse. They're bringing more of that light back down to the ground. But I would suggest to you that sky glow is a symptom of light pollution, but it's not light pollution itself. I have a much broader view of what that definition is, as you can see, which could be any kind of adverse effect that's associated with the use of what we call artificial light effect. And that has a component that's both indoors and outdoors. So what do we mean by our good friend Alan? Talk about Alan a lot in my office back in the States as though it's somebody who works down the hallway from us. Alan is artificial light at night. So any kind of use of light after sun goes down, sky gets dark, the landscape should be dominated by natural sources of light. The stars, the moon, the planets, maybe if you're far enough north or south, the aurora, air glow, which is an atmospheric phenomenon that emits faint light. Occasionally, there are other sources of light that are transient in the environment, like lightning or bushfire, but those don't usually last very long in the picture. So anything beyond those sources of light is considered to be artificial and therefore falls under this heading of Alan. The reason that I have two images over here is to suggest that there's an outdoor form of this problem and there's an indoor form. I make the distinction because the indoor issue is really wrapped up in concerns about impacts of light exposure on human health. You may have read stories in the media about this, that there's a little fringy science out there that says maybe exposure to all of this, especially blue light at night, is giving people cancer. Or it is starting the process of metabolic disruption that leads to diseases like diabetes or obesity. And there is scientific evidence to suggest that that may be the case. But this is an area that is really unsettled right now in terms of science. And while I say that the data are suggestive, they're not conclusive. So I don't want to be alarmist about the health effects. And anyways, as far as my organization is concerned, we're really not about indoor light, because our name is the Dark Sky Association. So we're going to focus more on the version up there at the top and why maybe lighting your city like that is not a good idea. So what can I tell you about ALIN, about artificial light at night? I can tell you a few things that we're pretty certain of based on decades of study at this point. One is that artificial light at night is, by definition, unnatural. If it's artificial, then it cannot be natural. We have sources of artificial light that mimic natural sources. And so as a room full of astronomers, you probably know what's going on over here on the left, right? Mm-hmm. So our primary reference for natural sources of light is the spectrum of the sun. And underneath the spectral lines is a continuous spectrum that's produced by a thermal source. So any light source that has a spectrum that kind of resembles sunlight, that could be moonlight, for example, is fairly natural. It's a thermal spectrum. And then from top to bottom, I'm listing different kinds of artificial light sources in sort of increasingly unnatural order. So a tungsten filament lamp, or in this case, a quartz halogen lamp, produces a more or less continuous spectrum because it's a hot thing, right? It's a thermal spectrum. It's a hot object giving off black body radiation. There are no spectral lines in this case because lamps don't have atmospheres like the sun. But then you start trekking down through these other sources and you'll find increasingly that their spectra don't look like the solar spectrum. Either there are parts where there is light that's missing altogether. There are, in some cases, bright emission lines superimposed on top of that thermal spectrum. Or in some cases, like compact fluorescent lights, there is no continuum anymore. It doesn't resemble a thermal source in the slightest. All you have are these emission lines. So why do I bring this up? This is unnatural in the sense that, in particular for biology, we evolved in a world in which there was a very clear light and dark pattern that started off early in the Earth's history as about an 18-hour cycle, when the orbit of the moon around the Earth was a lot closer, we were spinning faster, and has slowed since to 24 hours. But it slows so slowly that biology has plenty of time to react. So now we see a 24-hour cycle in most of the organisms that live at or near the surface of the Earth. And it's tuned to an input spectrum that looks like that. As we start taking colors out of the spectrum or adding more light in other cases, we're putting light into these biological systems that it doesn't quite know what to do with because it does not look like that natural spectrum of the sun. And in particular, I'm going to tell you about white light-emitting diodes, or LEDs, and I'm going to talk to you about that, what we call blue spike in the spectrum of the white LED that turns out to have a lot of potential for environmental harm. So keep in mind, ALIN is unnatural. And as a consequence of what I just said, ALIN is biologically active. And by that, I mean it can cause disruption to biological systems if you put the light into the system at a time when the organism's biology does not expect it to be there. So case in point, at night, once the sun has gone down, the sky is bright for a while, and that's actually a very blue source of light. But then when the sky becomes dark, the body no longer expects that light to be input into the eyes. Maybe the light from a fire, for example, which is a very warm kind of light, longer wavelengths down here. But what I'm showing you in this picture in particular, if my pointer will work, is that there are two things that line up extraordinarily well in this plot. So this is the sensitivity of the light-emitting system, or in the case of the heavy solid line, it's the emission, relatively speaking, of a blue-rich white LED, and these are the wavelengths of light with increasing wavelength towards the right, so redder colors. So the main thing I want you to notice is that the human sensitivity of the circadian system to light peaks at about a wavelength of 455 or so nanometers. So that's down here in the border. And by what turns out to be pure coincidence, that's also where white LEDs are emitting a great part of their spectral power. And that is a recipe for disaster. because it does not take much blue light to produce a physiological reaction in humans, animals, plants, you name it. We are exquisitely sensitive to light at that wavelength. And now more than ever, we're putting that light into the biological environment at night, and we don't know what to do with it. And there are consequences to that. I can tell you further that Allen is a global issue at this point. There's really no part of the world that it does not touch. You probably have seen an image like this before. That's often called the world at night, or sometimes referred to as the black marble. It's a composite image made from NASA satellite data that were taken over the course of about a year. In this case, I believe this map is from 2015. To make this map, the satellite that's orbiting the Earth is looking down constantly. So every time it orbits, it sees half the world in daylight, half the world at night. And over the course of a year, you get enough passes to where you observe all of the Earth under two conditions. One, it's dark, and the other, there are no clouds. Because otherwise you'd have weather superimposed all over this and it would be hard to tell what's going on. So the first thing you notice is that the land masses stand out in this kind of subdued blue color from the water, which is much darker, and that's because of moonlight. So just the light of the moon on the land is enough to light it up sufficiently to where we can differentiate the continents from the ocean. But then the next thing you notice is that there's all this kind of wider yellowish looking, these little spots of light superimposed on top of the image. And that is the light from the world cities, which is easily visible from space. That's the component of the light from the ground that's going up into the night sky and is completely escaping through the atmosphere. So in a sense, these are the lucky photons. These are the ones that didn't encounter an air molecule on the way up or a dust particle that caused them to be scattered in a different direction, causing our skies to light up at night. Astronauts see these too. They don't need any instruments to see it. They can look out the window of the space station. And our cities glow very brightly, so it's very easy for them to see. So there are two things to point out here, and one is, you might think about this and say, well, all right, this is where the people live, right? There's no light where people don't live, so it's not really all that surprising that there's not really any light up here in Siberia, there's not really any light in the interior of Australia, but there's plenty of light in the eastern half of North America, and Western Europe, and India, places like that. So, at one level, it does tell us something about where the people live, and so consequently, it says something about patterns of land use and that sort of thing. And we've been able to derive some interesting social science results from this. However, there are a tremendous number of people who live in sub-Saharan Africa, but it's not lit up as brightly as India or China or Europe. So this is also telling us something about the state of human development, economically speaking, around the world. Right? These people have not yet achieved a point in the industrialization of their economies where they can efficiently light up their cities. But I can tell you that they would like to. And the reason is that they view that as a sort of emblematic of a Western standard of living. So if you're North America or Western Europe or somewhere like that, you can afford to waste this resource because you're doing well. They're not at that stage yet. This is problematic for us as an organization because we are international and we would like, ideally, for the people living in Africa not to repeat the mistakes as we see it that we've made in the West. But we're also concerned about their economic development and the notion that we're depriving them of something if we don't allow them to light their cities. And there's a long colonial history in Africa that was very ugly, as many of you are aware. So, our approach to dealing with problems like this has to be very careful, is what I'm saying. What works in America doesn't necessarily work in Africa, doesn't necessarily work in China. And we have to adapt the message and the strategies to the place that we're working and try to be mindful of the past so that we don't reproduce some of the problems and errors that were committed in the past. So it's a global problem, and there's almost no part of the world now except for the extremes that it has not. So furthermore, to put up another couple of maps, artificial light at night use is absolutely growing out of control. I can't emphasize that enough. I'm going to be alarmist because among environmental pollutants in the world, this is something that's growing very rapidly. What I'm showing you in this picture, so think back to this map with the night lights as seen from satellites, So what the authors of this study did, this is Christopher Kaiba and co-workers who are based in Germany, they took those world maps of the light at night and they overlaid the boundaries of the countries, and then they started adding up the light inside of those boundaries. But they looked at it in two ways. They first asked, in a steady period between 2012 and 2016, for each country, how much of its land area was lit? So at the end of 2016, if more land was lit up at night than in 2012, that country shows up as a brighter red color, warmer color. And if it wasn't quite so much, it shows up as a blue color. But you'll notice that all of those numbers are positive numbers, which means that the rate of change was positive in every country on the earth. There are rare exceptions where, I'm going to show you in the second map, where there's incomplete data, but otherwise what we see is growth everywhere. Then in the second map they looked at, again, by country, the quantity of light. So not how it was distributed on the land, but how many total pixels on their camera were lit up. And the same thing, we see mostly warm colors indicating relatively large change. There are a few exceptions. People have asked what's going on with Australia over here. So it turns out the satellite sees more than just artificial light. It sees light from bushfires. And in those years, the bushfire rate declined countrywide. And so it looked like less of the land mass of Australia was lit in 2016 compared to 2012. So there's not really anything having to do with the human situation and the use of artificial light. That's a natural phenomenon. Something else, again, what this can tell us about social science that I find interesting is that a couple of the countries that turn blue are Syria and Yemen. And those were the only cases where the net change was approximately zero. And that has to do in both cases with the ongoing civil wars in those countries. As lights go out, it's an indication that people are at war with each other. So it's telling us something more than just about light pollution, but about the human condition. So change of area, change in radiance, in both of these quantities, the global average was 2% per year during that time, which is a doubling time of about 35 years. And by environmental standards, there's nothing that compares to that right now. It's growing faster than any other kind of environmental pollutant worldwide. So this is a view of how this is going, and it's not going well as far as that's concerned. There are places that it's a little better, a little worse, but the point is that it's growing everywhere, and it's growing very rapidly. So what is making the situation worse for us right now is the introduction of LED lighting. And I say it's making it worse, but we have to look at it in the bigger picture that, of course, you know, we as society have been promised that LED is good for the environment. It's much more energy efficient than other forms of outdoor lighting. And we support that wholeheartedly because we think that it's a great idea to reduce the world's energy consumption, reduce the world's carbon emission through fossil fuel burning. And we hope that people would use less light as a result, but as it turns out, they don't. And that's one of the other conclusions of this paper, is that there's a so-called rebound effect taking place in which the savings that are brought about by using this more energy efficient lighting are not going into reducing the demand for light, but instead they're being used to put out more light. And so it's ironically having the opposite effect. So if your MP says LED lighting is great because it's good for the environment, I would come in behind and say, if you use the savings to produce more light, there's nothing green about this, because in the end, you're using exactly the same amount of energy. And inadvertently, you may be causing a further kind of environmental destruction. So if you're just exchanging one for the other, that doesn't sound like very good policy to me. But here's why LED is important for impact to the night sky. And that is, in short, that converting from the older kinds of lighting that we still have in many cities in the world, including Auckland, to LED, while not changing any of the parameters, has the capacity to make the night sky much brighter than it is now. What I'm showing you in this picture are two still frames from an animation that was produced by a group called the Flagstaff Dark Sky Coalition in my home state of Arizona in the US. Flagstaff was the world's first international dark sky community, and it had the world's first outdoor lighting policy way back to the late 1950s. They were light years ahead of the world on this. And that's because there are a lot of astronomical observatories within a short distance of Flagstaff. And for them, it's an important contributor to the global economy. So it's good that they keep the sky dark over Flagstaff because it enables them to keep doing professional astronomy from the ground. So they're very concerned about this and seeing the end of what they call their low pressure sodium lighting system. What you have predominating, as far as I can tell, in Auckland is what we call high pressure sodium. They're kind of those sort of peach colored lights that you see around town. Low pressure sodium is a variant on that that produces more of a light that's it's a very dull kind of orange yellow. Anybody's been to the UK, they have these sodium lights all over the country still. And this kind of lighting is great for astronomy. And that's because, thinking back to those spectra that I showed earlier, low pressure sodium just emits a little bit of light in the orange, very narrow little couple of lines, and that's it. So if you're an astronomer, you can put a filter into your beam of your telescope that effectively blocks all of that light. It's more complicated as you start distributing the light throughout the rest of the spectrum. And that's what we're doing, is shifting from that kind of a technology to LED. So as part of the city's decision on what to do about converting its lights over, they were presented with a number of options, one of which was relatively blue-rich white LED. And so to show the impact of a decision like that, the Dark Sky Coalition did the simulation that shows a view of Flagstaff from 20 kilometers distance, looking back in the city's direction. So you can tell where the city is, it's where the light is. And they did that for the existing low-pressure sodium streetlight system. And then they did a simulation where they replaced every one of those low-pressure sodium streetlights with one of these blue-rich white LEDs, like you're seeing in some parts of Auckland now. And going from the top to the bottom, there's no change in the total amount of light emitted. So you think, how is this possible? It looks an awful lot brighter in the lower image. But he just said to you that there's no difference in the total light emission between these two sources. And the secret to understanding this is the knowledge that, for the same reason that the sky is blue during the daytime, those blue wavelengths of light are really good at scattering as they move through the atmosphere. So the probability that a photon, blue photon, emitted upward into the night sky from this Flagstaff is going to scatter back down to the ground before it has a chance to leave the atmosphere. So because of that same phenomenon, now we've gone to from seeing almost 3,000 stars on the night, seeing the Milky Way from just outside of town, to a much more washed out sky, half of the stars, and what is apparently a much brighter city. So this is the potential impact of converting your lighting over to LED, even if you keep the quantity of light the same. That's an important part. So that implies that if we dimmed our lights down below typical illumination levels, that we could push back a little bit against the tendency for LED to light up our skies worse. So keep this in mind. Something that a lot of times that you might read in the news, and I've seen at least in our media in the United States, is a claim by lighting manufacturers and city officials and people tasked with making decisions about lighting, that white LED is great because it's just like moonlight. Just like them. And they say that because this white LED has what we call a color temperature of 4,000 Kelvin. Color temperature is a great way of describing the spectral content of a black body, like the sun. The sun is about a 6,000 Kelvin black body. Okay, sounds good. So moonlight has a color temperature of about 4,000 Kelvin. So I plotted in orange the spectrum of the moon at kind of an average distance off the horizon, so it includes some atmospheric extinction. And I've overplotted in white the spectrum of a 4,000 Kelvin white LED. These sources are nothing like each other, right? So there's much more red emission in moonlight and far less blue emission. But lighting companies have been trying to sell this lighting on the basis of, well, you're all familiar with moonlight. You know what that looks like, right? You can see just fine. It's just like moonlight. And I assure you that it is not. And from a biological perspective, these things are nothing like each other. So what happens is LEDs is changing cities for better or worse. They said that the astronauts aboard the space station can see our cities at night as they pass underneath. And some of them, on their off time, like to hang out in a part of the space station called the cupola, which is a panoramic set of windows with handheld DSLR cameras and very long zoom lenses. And they just take pictures of whatever they see out of the city, windows, and a lot of those at night are the Earth cities, and they've gotten some fantastic images. This is the city of Milan in Italy in two different years. And you can guess what happened between 2012 and 2015. So Milan changed out the lights in its city center from the warm kind of orange glow of the sodium lights to very high color temperature white LED. And the residents hated it. They described it as being very sterile, kind of hospital-like lighting, shines in their windows at night, a lot of glare, they're having trouble sleeping, and the city says, you told us to save you money. We have to hit carbon reduction targets for the EU. We put in these lights, they're gonna last 25 years, you should thank us. We're seeing this played out in city after city after city. And in many cases, the people who live there don't know that it's happening until the light goes up outside their house. And then when they call to complain, it's too late because the city has gone through its procurement process and bought all of these lights that will replace the ones that exist now. And that comparison with Flagstaff here, the last manufacturer of this type of lamp, the low-pressure sodium lamp, is Philips. And they have announced that in June 2019, they are ceasing production of those lamps. So the remaining holdouts that haven't undergone this kind of conversion in the world are going to go through it, if for no other reason than the market demand is really pushing in that direction. So you could say, hey, it's great. Milan is saving a lot more money now. They're reducing their carbon emission. It's better for the environment. But if the residents hate it, and they put up a lot more lights than there used to be, was it ultimately a good decision? It's an open question. Why is all this happening? I thought about this, I thought, how can I condense this down in the fewest words possible? There's three kind of dependent statements up here. But at the end of the day, the reason all of this is happening is that people simply aren't thinking about this as an issue. Many of them still don't think that light pollution is a real kind of pollution, that it's sort of, if you do something about it or care about it, it's sort of optional. You know, we have real social problems over here, and we astronomers, we hear you, but we really don't. But what this implies is that pictures like this one in the background, that this is not inevitable. Our cities don't have to look like this. And that they could be different if we were mindful about the ways that we're using light. So that's the kind of first suggestion here is we need to change the way we think about this issue. Because if we did, I think we would find that we needed a lot less light to do all of the things that we're doing now. And we could have all of our legitimate human needs for light at night covered. We can do it in a way that wasn't environmentally destructive. But first, I have to convince the world that it wants to do this. Because dragging them along through policy, that might work, but that's not the best way of achieving this goal, I submit to you. So now I'm going to suggest why you should care about this issue beyond the impact of the night sky. Your out-of-town observing sites getting further away every year. This map is a little bit different than the one that I showed you before. This is a product of what's called the New World Atlas of Artificial Night Sky Brightness. It was published in June 2016. And it's the result of another five-year study looking at all of the world, taking those night lights from the earlier image, combining it with a model of how light propagates through the Earth's atmosphere at night, and using it to predict for every point on the Earth's surface how bright is the zenith, the point in the sky directly overhead. How bright is that relative to an assumption about how bright it would be if there were no lights of an artificial nature in the world? So you start with this kind of baseline where the world would be without artificial light. You ask, how many times brighter are you than that? Because even out here in the middle of the ocean, the sky is not black at night. It's not totally black. Under a clear sky, there's enough of that natural light, starlight and other things, that you don't start down here at zero, you start up here. That's a natural, pristine sky. And then there's degrees of how much brighter it becomes after that. So that's what the colors indicate. As you go from these dark grays and blues up to the yellows and the reds, et cetera, that means increasing brightness of the zenith. So I'm not talking about what's happening down at your horizon, because it's a common point in the sky that we can make comparisons. So if you live in the eastern United States or central and western Europe, you're done. You can see there's kind of a dividing line here in the US, and there's some dark places that are left out west, But east of a line running through the middle of our country and going eastward there, there is now nowhere in the eastern United States where the brightness of the night sky reaches a natural level at night. There is nowhere. Because the background here never goes to zero. And the same is true in Europe and parts of coastal China and Japan, etc. And these little bubbles of color are expanding outward every year. The problem is getting worse. It's forcing people to go further and further away if they want to find that natural darkness. So that underscores the reason why, number one, protecting what's still left is important. But number two, it's really hard to roll back damage after it's occurred. So it's better to keep things in a condition that they are rather than trying to make things better after the problem has already developed. So this frames context of what we're trying to accomplish, is to push back where we can and to preserve what is still left. For the benefit of understanding our universe and being able to do astronomy research, I've written here, astronomy budgets are flat. Here's some US funding, which is the blue line right here for astronomy in constant dollars. Telescopes are expensive, and space is hard. This is the James Webb Space Telescope, which you might have heard of, that my country is working on. And it hasn't launched. It was supposed to have launched 15 years ago. It was supposed to have cost, something like $2.6 billion. It's currently at $8.8 billion and growing, and our Congress is rapidly losing its patience with NASA due to the cost overruns. It's got this very elaborate segmented mirror that folds up, and this sunshade folds up to all fit inside the fairing of the rocket that will deliver it to space. And when it gets out there, it has to blossom like a flower with dozens of moving parts at 20 degrees above absolute zero in space. And it has to perform flawlessly. They did a test of the now mostly assembled spacecraft a couple weeks ago. It was called a shake test, where they put the whole thing on a big vibrating platform and they simulate the stress of launch in a rocket. So they subject it to all of these vibrations. And when they did, bolts started falling. So when I tell my friends that are still working in academic astronomy, you know, there's a non-zero chance that Congress will decide that it's reached its limit with NASA and it will cancel this program. Until the day that your spacecraft is delivered to orbit, up to the last minute, you can be canceled. And they say, oh no, that would never happen. They've already spent all this money. Why would they walk away from it? 30 years ago, the United States was building a large particle collider that was supposed to be long before the Large Hadron Collider in Europe was going to turn on, and we were going to find all this new physics and find the Higgs particle and all of that. And they got into part of the construction phase, and cost overruns caused our Congress to cancel the project. And now, as I like to say, there are giant underground holes in Texas that are filling with water that were supposed to have been the track for the superconducting super collider. So if anybody thinks that our Congress will not cancel this project, believe me, they will. And that would be a near-death blow to astronomy because of all of the science that's riding on this. We can't rely on going to space for everything. There's still a very good market for doing astronomy from the ground, but it depends on an access to the night sky. It's just so much cheaper to operate from. And we can do so much more instrument development, tweaking, and all of that, that we will literally not be able to do with James Webb. This is not the Hubble. There's no space shuttle. There are no servicing missions. There will be no updates to its instrumentation. If something fails on that spacecraft, it is dead in the water. There's a lot riding on that. I would rather invest more in the infrastructure on the ground, where if something fails, we can pick it up and move it. Or we can take it back to the shop and work on it and make it work. So keep in mind, budgets are flat, telescopes are expensive, and space is hard. At the same time, all of this light is causing increasing environmental pressures on lots and lots of species, sometimes for better, sometimes for worse, and that's what the two images illustrate. Over here on the left, I'm sure everybody's had the experience of seeing bright lighting over a car park or an athletic field. It's left on all night, even when people are around, and during certain times of year, they can attract hordes of insects. And that's in part because the insects are tuned to that blue light, once again, that light is emitting, because they think it's the sun, and they're programmed to fly in that direction. So at night, they see what looks to them a lot like sunlight, and they make, pardon the pun, a beeline for that light. And if you're a bird, this is great, right? This is a big food source that you don't have to go and find. You can just keep diving through the beam and catching insects every time you do. But on the other side, also speaking of birds, these are dead birds. There's a group in Canada called the Fatal Light Awareness Project, or FLAP for short. They've been trying to raise the alarm in Canadian cities for about 15 years. And what this group does is they go around cities in places like Toronto and Ottawa, and they go around at night with garbage bags and kitchen tongs, and they pick up bird carcasses. These birds are their take from one night in Toronto. And they were all killed in collisions with the lit windows of skyscrapers. And that's because they were diverted from their migratory flyways. They were fatally attracted to the light of the city, so they're diverted from the path they should be taking. They get into the downtown area where now there's light in all kinds of directions. They start flying around, flying circles, and they'll either drop dead of exhaustion or they'll fly to the windows. So if you multiply this by all the world's cities and all the world's migratory bird species, estimates range from below tens of millions up to perhaps a billion birds a year that are killed in these collisions. And believe me, all of these species are already under a lot of pressure from other sources like climate change. And many of them are approaching a tipping point where it will not take very much to drive them to extinction. And we are setting them up, in some cases, for extinction as a result of our overuse of light. I also probably don't have to tell you that the world's demand for energy is increasing, and despite the fact that there are countries like New Zealand that lead in the use of renewables, much of the world is still addicted to carbon. And this is from the Energy Information Agency, that's part of the U.S. Department of Energy, making some assumptions about the future growth of demand for all kinds of renewables. And only by about 2035 or so are they starting to predict that there will be a turnover in the demand for coal. Well, look, a lot of the demand is going to be in the form of liquid biofuels, so liquefied natural gas, that sort of thing. We're still using a lot of carbon, and that has consequences. I come from a country where a lot of people don't like to believe in climate change, and I tell them that that's okay because climate change believes in you. And it's happening, and humans are lost. So to the extent that we're using that energy to produce light that is on all night, and it's lighting up places that don't need that light in inappropriate quantities, et cetera, lighting up the night sky, you can draw a direct line back to all that energy use and the geopolitical consequences that come with it. Light can be used to either enhance personal security and safety, generally public safety, or it can degrade it. Two images taken with the same camera, same settings, everything. Very typical American approach to doing things. You often will find people who have a bright light on the side of their house. It's lighting up the side because they think it's a deterrent to people snooping around in their yards, maybe trying to break into their house. And it's only when the photographer reaches out his hand and blocks the glare from that light do you realize that there's a person standing in the open gate. That person is up here, you can't see them because of the glare of the light that lights the camera. A similar logic applies to road safety. Glare from lighting is known to be a problem. Of course, lighting roads is good, especially lighting roads in what we call conflict zones where you have different types of traffic coming into intersection with each other, right? And as an organization, ID will always, always, always come down on the side of safety. When there's a safety issue, we say light. Because we do not, by any means, intend to take something away from people when we know that it works and it improves public safety. But if we use light like this, I would say that it actually degrades public safety. Not only have you shown a thief, for example, potentially what you have to steal, but you've given that person light by which to operate. Because I guarantee you, your neighbors are not out at 3 in the morning looking over the fence to see if anybody is bothering things. But there's this belief still that that bright light deters criminal activity, but I can tell you there's really not a shred of scientific evidence for that. So we may be creating more of a problem that we're solving. There is an increasing astrotourism industry in countries like New Zealand, and the light from distant cities is beginning to affect that. Case in point, the last couple of years I've gone as an invited speaker to the Grand Canyon in Arizona, where they have a big star party every year in June. And it's a massive event, and they have thousands of people that show telescope for it. Hundreds of astronomers bringing hundreds of telescopes, and it's fantastically successful. But the last couple of years that I've gone there, standing in the Grand Canyon, which is about, as the crow flies, about 300 kilometers or so from Phoenix, which is our state capital, and a brilliant source of light, and even across that distance, I can see the glow of Phoenix on the horizon. Or I can turn to the left, look down the long axis of the canyon to the west, and I can see the glow from Las Vegas, which is a comparable distance. Las Vegas has a tourism slogan, which is what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. And assure them that what happens in Vegas doesn't stay in Vegas because I can see it at the Grand Canyon. So I did a little back of the envelope calculation. I said, all right, I know what the distance is from the Grand Canyon to Las Vegas. It's so many miles. I assume that the light dome of Las Vegas is visible from at least that radius all the way around the city. That means that the light footprint of Las Vegas is at a minimum 100,000 square miles. And because I'm an American, I don't even know what that is in square kilometers, but it's big. So to the extent that we have dark sky parks in that region of the country and other places, they're potentially threatened by the light of cities because it has such a great reach away from the cities. And as I showed you earlier, white LED is making that a lot worse. And so to the extent that these kind of activities are now related to economic development in rural areas, you're potentially doing economic harm to the parts of the country that can least afford it. So let's zoom into New Zealand and talk about the proximity challenge. So here is a map of your lovely country that shows the location of Lake Taupo and Great Barrier Island, which are the two locations here currently certified as part of our International Dark Sky Places program. I had the pleasure of visiting both of them in person on my trip, and I found them fantastic. And what I'm showing you on the right side is the same sort of political topographic map underneath, but now with an overlay related to that map that I showed you that was the predicted brightness of the night sky at the zenith. So the first thing that you'll notice is, well, there's a lot of really dark territory, especially down on the South Island, mainly because nobody lives there, but it's still dark. That's good. It's easy to defend, generally speaking, the places that are still dark. The problem is that where the light now exists, it's a lot harder to do something about it. And you'll notice, and I'm looking at you, Christchurch, that the outermost contour here, which is kind of the limit of the visibility of the light dome from Christchurch, this is many tens of kilometers out to sea. To give you an idea, again, of that light footprint. And so, being a largely kind of coastal country in terms of where your population is concentrated, now you're having an impact on an ocean ecosystem as well. It's not just limited to the land. But we still have all these dark areas. We can work with that. And in the cities, if we improve things, maybe we'll make it better. So that's a good thing to start out with. New Zealand is also pretty far behind, relatively speaking. That growth rate that I was talking about earlier, that the world is getting brighter at 2% per year. So that same paper that I showed you, the maps with all the colors on it earlier, the different countries, also went country by country by country and looked at the way those numbers were distributed. And so what they plotted up here in blue in both cases is the average of all the countries in the world. So here's the lit area of the country by different bins of gradient. So what that means is you're going from dimmer parts of the country to brighter parts of the country. And of course, you assume if the population is concentrated in the cities, like it is here, that this should slope downward. So it looks basically like we expect. But looking at the way that that has changed is kind of interesting because these little now markers are now kind of all over the place. The reasons for that are complex, but they're not outside of what we would expect. But again, notice that you were below the world average in both cases. Once again, that's good. You should work with us. Astrotourism is on its way up here. I've been going around talking to people about how to put together kind of a strategy for how we can market this nationally and take some pressure off of places like Lake Taupo, where they've got more nighttime tourism than they know what to do with, and it's beginning to stress the infrastructure. Distributing in other parts of the country, like Great Barrier, for example, other places along the length of New Zealand, to where people will come and stay for 7 days, 10 days, instead of just coming to Taupo and spending 3 nights. and the economic impact of that will be proportionally better. So this is good news. New Zealand is increasingly known as a destination for this kind of tourism. And also, as a consequence, people are finding out about you in places that are far from here. So this was the headline in the Telegraph in the UK just after the Great Barrier announcement. Is this the world's greatest island for stargazing? I love how they phrase these as questions and just kind of leave them hanging out there. But they also talk about, you know, Stewart Island. This is about the town of Naseby in the central Otago. Great things are happening. People are finding out about it. The media is interested. They're writing stories. This is good. We can work with this. And that is what I want to do. But the problem that we're facing specifically, and it's not endemic to New Zealand, it's pretty much all countries, is that our way of designing and implementing lighting is still lagging behind sort of best practice. We're not doing as well as we could. You have some standards that are kind of antiquated. I am desperately trying to get through to somebody at New Zealand Transport Authority, and they don't really want to talk to me. They have some guidance for lighting the roads in this country that is dated 2014, and in terms of the lifetime of the typical product on the commercial lighting market, that's 2.5 lifetimes ago, because that average lifetime is about 18 months. So they're dispensing guidance for lighting the roadways here that is arguably out of date, and so consequently is not as good as it can be. This is sort of their vision for how New Zealand's roadways should be lit, with a lot of light and a lot of very blue light. They're really strongly advocating for a 4,000 Kelvin standard for white LED. And they're offering the councils and municipalities as much as an 85% subsidy to cover the cost of converting the lights. But if you take the money to do the conversion, you have to follow their guidelines, and it looks like this. Mm-hmm. So this picture back here where I said we've got something useful to work with, because so much of New Zealand is still dark. Again, applying that example from Flagstaff, if we convert a lot of these lights over to LED, these light bubbles are going to get a lot bigger, and they're going to start really putting pressure on those rural areas where it's still dark. So what we're trying to do is get the government to think differently about how it wants to light the country, and to convince them that it can be done in a way that's still very cost effective, so you get all those benefits for energy efficiency, protects public safety, while not causing undue environmental damage. That's the goal. But first I need to get them to talk to you. So I'm going to end with a vision for what the Auckland area could be. But I'm going to start from where we're sort of at now. This is the most recent space station image that I could find from Auckland, which is dated 2013. And that's only because there's no formal program for the astronauts to take pictures specifically of certain cities over time. And by chance, this is the newest one that I can find. And I believe this is oriented so this is roughly north in this direction.
Yep.
Yeah. It's an oblique view, so it's not looking straight down on the earth. It's looking at a pretty lefty angle, but there's, you know, a downtown. You can see all the development down here, across the on the other side. So there's a fair amount of light here. Here is a map from earlier with those predicted sky brightnesses, but now I've zoomed in specifically to the area around Auckland and the forest, you know. Here's where all the people live. This is where the most intensity is. But here's that sort of outer contour which defines the limit of the visibility of the Auckland Light Dome, and it is very large. And it is filling up the harbor over here, or the bay. Here's Great Barrier. How many people have been out there, by the way? Fairly good number of you. You've been out there at night? I was out there 2 nights ago trying to drive on that island without street lights, and I was thinking, I wish there were street lights. I mean, it was overcast, it was raining intermittently, and in that example I showed earlier where the clouds over the city were making the sky glow brighter, clouds over a dark place make it dark, right? Because now you're blocking all the natural light in the sky. That was the darkest place I think I've been in my life, Great Barrier Island, with an overcast sky. But look how close it is to Auckland. Right as the crow flies, this is something like 100 kilometers, which is not that far to have such incredible darkness. So this is kind of our model for where we might get the outermost parts of this area to be if we decrease some of the brightness from the interior. We're not going to bring back visibility of the Milky Way from the city. We know that. But in these outer areas, could we shrink this down a bit and make it a little more favorable for doing astronomy? Yeah, I think we could. But it would take a concerted effort and getting your local government on board in order to be able to do that.
I was just going to say, one of their favorite places is going to that place where it says Barangal. There's also fairly high hills between Barangal and what says Pascara here. And that does actually help cut the sky low up from the city as well.
It's actually to your advantage that it's kind of a hilly terrain in a lot of these areas. Topography is really good at screening out light. So this it's much better than if this were just a completely flat plain, right? In which case the light would go in every direction. So it does work in your favor in that case to have some topography to land on the screen out some of that light.
So does this take into account the topography?
Does not take into account the topography, actually. This map assumes that the land is flat. So that's a good point, and I'm glad that you brought this up. The degree to which that topography matters really depends on the height. And so for low hills and things like that, probably does not have a lot of screening function. But even on Great Barrier, which is, the topography is much more elevated in here, the screening effect out there is really dramatic. And the little bit of light that's getting up to the island from Auckland is effectively screened out by the middle of the island. If you're on the eastern half, you don't see it at all. So, one thing that we can conclude by zooming in on that map, now this is again just the direct light emission, it's not the model on top of it, it's just the direct light emission. So there's downtown, here's the airport, et cetera. Is that by and large, light emission follows where the population is? Is this population density map more or less resembles what you see on the right? Although nobody really lives at the airport, but the airport is very bright for other reasons. So it's not a perfect analog, but we can learn something about it by looking at this remote sensing data. And remote sensing can also help us figure out where the trouble spots are. So I took images from the Suomi NTP satellite, which is the NASA facility that made the world map from earlier, zoomed in on Auckland in these two different epochs, 2012 and 2017, and then I subtracted one from the other. Now, why do these look black on white? It's just because I flipped the colors around to make it a little easier to see what's going on. So the darker colors over here mean more light, instead of the other way around. But if I subtract one from the other, now I get bright against dark. So everywhere there's a bright spot here, that's a place that in 2017 was brighter than in 2012. Right? So we can start to figure out where that is. So I took this result and I overlaid it on a map of Auckland, and now you start to see where the little individual bright spots are. So a lot of new light at the airport, for one thing. You'll notice that these blobs of light all have about roughly the same size, which is the limit of the resolution of the satellite. And its ability to see land is down to about squares of 750 meters on a side. So if there's a source of light that's somewhere in here that's smaller than that, it's going to look like it's 750 meters on a side. So that's just the resolution of the satellite. But we can go through exercises like this to try to figure out what parts of the city are the brightest, what parts are the dimmest, how are they growing, then go look at things like land use maps and figure out why are these places getting brighter. And so we can very quickly get to some strategies for how to deal with the problem. So what can be done? Certainly we can look at the way light is used in the city and see if there are options for making that better, or educating people to make better choices about how they're using lighting. This is a neat infographic that we did a couple of years ago that tried to condense into something we could fit on the back of a postcard. The recommendations that we would make for people who are lighting their homes, their businesses, et cetera, and want to do better by that in just a few simple steps. And a lot of it simply has to do with making sure that the light is only used in the places and times that it's necessary in the right amount for the task, and with some sensitivity to the color in order to try to limit the environmental damage. Five things. If I can get every homeowner, every business owner to think about these five things when they choose lighting for their property, we could solve this problem in much less than a generation. But it's getting people to think about these things that's important. So if we're going to kind of analyze what we're using lighting for in Auckland and figure out if there are places that we can improve it, I would recommend using those 5 points as means for determining what's good, what's bad, and what could be better. you have a lot of lights left yet to convert over to LED. I've seen a lot of sodium lighting here. I've seen some really not great white LED installations. I've seen some installations that, with a little bit of rain on the pavement, are potentially damaging to public safety, that I think are going to cause traffic accidents. The light is too bright. The light is too bright, and it's the wrong color, and it is actually solving few problems and possibly creating much bigger ones. So to the extent that council still has the ability to control this process and maybe make some changes to the kind of lighting that it's using, I've had a little dialogue with them, and they said, well, we're just following the NCTA guidelines, and they say we have to do this and this and this in order to get the subsidy. Well, is it worth it? If you create other problems, is it worth it? And I ask that non-rhetorically because I think people need to think really hard about this. We are told that these lights will last in the field for 25, maybe 30 years, right? That's one of the selling points. So if you're making decisions for your resident base that are going to last 25 years, I think you owe them a lot of due diligence in making the right decision, not just the cheapest one, right? If we knew that we were going to replace these lights in 5 years, we'll see where the technology is at that point. But they're representing to you that this is a generational choice. And as a consequence, I think the politicians making big decisions like that should really do their homework before they commit to that. So can we do something about the remaining retrofits? We really ought to undertake a comprehensive look at all the policies about outdoor lighting in this place. Figure out what's working, what isn't, what is out of date, maybe by decades. And come out with something that is more workable for the community, that I think would also have the benefit of reducing light pollution. And that would be great for everybody. And then we should, to the greatest extent we can, try to create some buffers in the surrounding territories. Again, shout out to everybody in Waikiki. You're part of that solution. So going back to that map of the zenith brightnesses, we've got some great data that's actually taken on the island with sensors that measure the brightness of the night sky. So we're comparing it against sort of the prediction. And these are the actual measurements. And as we go further and further and further out to the east, the island gets darker and darker and darker. Plenty of light on the island, but this is more reflective of the light from Auckland City proper as it's impacting the island. If we can establish some protected areas in places like Waikiki or the Waitakere's, we can help push back a little bit. Especially if it sort of becomes a point of civic pride to have a dark sky park on your doorstep right here, then it's really important to try to preserve that. So that can be used as a point of leverage. Engage the public. You guys are great at this. Amateur astronomers wrote the book on public outreach, right? To the extent that this issue interests you, there are plenty of opportunities to become involved, to educate the public, to become activists to the extent that you're comfortable, and to help create positive change in your community. So when I get towards the end of talks like this, people say, all right, does it work? If I do all the things that you're asking me to do, what happens to the night sky? Well, here's one result from our Dark Sky Reserve in Quebec, in Canada, which was founded in 2008. And they looked at data from before and after the establishment of the Dark Sky Reserve, which involved going around to a bunch of little towns at the foot of a mountain, the top of which is a professional observatory. And they changed out lights in order to meet the requirements for participation in the program. And jargon, the level of the sky rates, the fire. Translation is the sky deck. They've been making measurements of the night sky over Mount Meganic since the late 1970s. And they found that by switching out all of the mercury lamps in the areas around the park with, at that time, was mostly high pressure sodium, that all the light in those mercury lines went away. And the sky literally got darker. So the answer is yes. Yes, it does work. Does it work? Yes. There's a study that I did in my own home city. This is Tucson, Arizona. This is in 2014 and 2017, between which we converted over our lights from mostly high-pressure sodium to warm white LED, 3,000 Kelvin. But what the city did that it didn't make a big deal about to the public was it also cut the total emission of light from our street lighting system by 60%. We lost hundreds of millions of lumens of light in the conversion. But because, again, going back to the chart with all the spectra on it, that LED light moves a little more down into the bluer colors, and it turns out that at low light levels, the eye is more adapted to blue colors at low intensity in Tucson don't even realize that the city did it. I talked to the engineer who was the project lead on this, and I asked him, so how many complaints have you gotten about the new street lighting system? And he says, you can count them on two hands. We're a metro area of almost 1 million people. Because to the dark adapted eye, the scene illumination under the new lights looks a lot like the scene illumination of the old lights. People don't realize. They're not worried about public safety because they don't think there's any net change. They notice the difference in color, but they think our streets are illuminated the same way as they were before. So we made some measurements on the ground before and after the LED conversion, knowing that this dimming was taking place. Our models predicted that the sky glow should be decreased by about 10%, and our measurements from the ground showed that it decreased by about 7%. And this is the same sort of game that I was playing with the Occam map, subtracting one from the other. We added this up, so this is the light escaping all the way through the atmosphere, and we got a decrease of something like 8%. So does it work? Yes. By dimming our lights to reasonable levels that are consistent with international recommendations for illumination, and having currently done no harm to our public safety, we were able to decrease the brightness of the night sky. I call that a win. And I wish other cities would consider doing that. I'll let you read this. This is the kind of thing that we have in mind for what Auckland could be if people want it that way. And again, this is cost effective. This preserves public safety. This gives you all the benefits of LED lighting that you've been promised. And it does it in a way that's not disruptive to the nighttime environment. So in conclusion, the future of the nights in this urban environment depends very strongly on the decisions that are being made right now. There's plenty of room for people to be involved in this process, to try to influence it, to try to increase public understanding of the issue, awareness of the issue, and hopefully we'll end up with a better outcome for Auckland and beyond, because it will affect a lot of people beyond those that just live here in the area. And so with that, I thank you for your attention. I'm happy to take your questions.
Thanks very much, John. I haven't included you with a chance to talk to our public officials. For questions.
Yes, thanks for a very inspiring talk. What is the price differential between warm LEDs at the moment and cold LEDs, and is that gap falling quickly?
So the question was whether there is a difference in cost between warm and cool LEDs, and the answer I can tell you is that, broadly speaking, as those terms are defined, those are now in parity. So the cost, there's no cost difference. It used to be that the objections for those against those warmer LEDs were they cost more, they don't get as good energy efficiency, they don't render colors as well. So think about how well you can see the color of something under the light. And one by one, the technology has developed to the point where all of those are now equal. So what I say to people that are in elected capacities that are making decisions about this is, at this point in time in the history of this lighting product, if you opt for high color temperature, cool white, blue rich light, you do so because it is an aesthetic choice. And there are organizations like NZT that will tell you, well, you know, it's safer for vehicle traffic if we have more of this blue color for various reasons. And then you ask them, what evidence do you have for that? And they've had a hard time coming up with it. Because somebody in the lighting industry is trying to sell them something and they told them that this is better for roadway safety. But there is not a lot of evidence about this. So that's what I tell them is, you know, you have a choice. You have a couple of options here. They both cost the same. They both have otherwise the same properties. And you're making an aesthetic choice about the color of the light, pretty much.
Well, is street lighting the biggest source compared to domestic and commercial lighting?
That's a good question. So it's about whether street lighting is the majority of light emitted by a city. Is it a small percentage, big percentage, etc.? And the best we know from looking at measurements on the ground and in space is that we think in the typical city, street lighting accounts for about 50% of the light that escapes to space. So street lighting is tremendously important, and it it's just there's so much of it in typical cities. So when we do things like the simulations, we pretend like a city consists of nothing but street lighting. We don't take into account private lighting on homes and businesses and things like that. That's where it gets very tricky, because we don't know exactly what the fractions are for those other kinds of lights, but we're pretty confident that street lighting accounts for the bulk of the light that is producing the sky glow and is also being seen from space.
When in perhaps 20 years' time we have cars that we don't sit and drive automatically, will we then be able to reduce the street lights so profoundly that we'll darken up the space again?
I believe that completely. So the question was about whether self-driving cars or autonomous vehicles will be something of a game changer in that regard, because they don't use optical light to sense where they're at on a road, right? They're using infrared light, or they're using something called LIDAR. They're using these other methods. So it naturally leads to, in rural areas, could we go without any kind of roadway lighting at all? Probably true. In cities, it's going to be trickier, because you'll still have pedestrians, you'll still have bicyclists. They're going to need to see those autonomous vehicles so as not to crash into them. Very famously, in my own state, Uber lost a self-driving car a few weeks ago when it struck and killed a pedestrian.
Yes.
Right? And I looked at that video very carefully, and you know where it occurred? It was on a dark stretch of road, and there was no crosswalk. And the system utterly failed to detect the person walking out into the road. So I think we still have a ways to go with technology. But we know that at low speeds, so the type of speed you would drive at in residential areas, headlights are much more effective at helping a driver see a moving object than overhead lighting is. Speeds at below about 50 kilometers an hour or so. So already we have an indication that headlights do a great job. We'll put probably put headlights on autonomous vehicles so that they can be seen by people, so they don't collide with them. But we'll have much less of a dependence on those roadway lights overhead to prevent those interactions from happening. That's where it comes.
Just one thing I know about when I saw the dash cam video of that incident, it looked like the pedestrian had no idea the car was approaching either. But presumably the car had headlights.
It did.
So presumably if it had been a human driver,
I don't think this was an electric version. No. They're going to have to confront that problem as well. The headlights on the car were on. It turns out that the human driver who was behind the controls but not controlling the car was not paying attention, was actually looking at his phone.
Yes.
But also, on this dark stretch of road, there was a woman, looked like she was walking a bicycle, that just stepped right out in front of the car. And I'm still at a loss to explain why someone would do that. So that's a whole other dimension to the issue.
You had a lot of comment on one of the things that LEDs can do and then dim. Basically the city light control central source now. They've actually got into dimming by neighborhood, but that's potentially possible.
Yes. That is part of the future, very definitely, are generally what we call adaptive controls. And dimmers are one of those. Timers are another. So that you can say after a certain hour of night, the lights dim down to some fraction or they extinguish completely. People are working on technologies now that are even become smarter than that in sensing the amount of traffic on the road and adjusting the light levels accordingly, or being able to shift the color of the light. So if you say that road safety is important and you think the bright blue lights are good for that, you can have that light during the evening rush hour, and then as the traffic level begins to taper down, that light starts to shift and it becomes warmer and warmer and warmer, and then later on it starts to dim, 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 and you do it so slowly that people can't sense that it's happening. So it's not an instantaneous transition, so they're not sort of, it's not jarring when it happens. That's coming. Lights that are fully automated and fully intelligent are coming, where imagine you have a string of street lights along the street. They're all talking to each other because they're individually addressable on a network. And they're all, the starting condition is all the lights are off. And there's a car approaching. And the first first light in the string senses the approach of the car, it ramps up the brightness of the light as the car passes underneath it, and then as the car passes, it ramps back down, and the next light already knows it's coming and begins to. Because the dimming capability, you can do that, and you can do it in a non-destructive way to the lamp. We can't do this with these sodium lights out here, because if you extinguish the light, it takes a couple of minutes for the light to come back on. So again, we think that LED is great, because it has some really great properties that let us really control how the light is used. But what we're finding is that it's still somewhat of an expensive add-on to a lot of the lighting systems that are being sold, and cities are not adopting it.
Yeah.
So encouraging them to do that is something
that
we're working on.
It's not really playing on dimming, it's probably looking at just tuning off every second to do it. So,
yeah, there are different ways you can do it through.
They were swapped out here and started in 2014. Around One Tree Hill here was done about 2016.
Mm-hmm.
And we do sort of search based astronomy here, so we measure the background all the time. Maybe we've got a sensor on the roof. And just my own experience is that the streets around here are noticeably darker at night. And they're just standing under an LED. The main thing is the shielding. So if you sort of swap them out and you keep the crappy shielding, you definitely make a problem. And so if you shield the lights, you definitely make a problem.
Shielding lights is the single most important contributor to reducing sky glow. Even if you're not paying attention to the color of the lights or any other properties that we're talking about, shielding definitely works. I have an acquaintance who is a lighting designer, used to be on the board of our organization, who famously said once, anybody talking about the glare from lighting and people complaining about glare, anybody who looks up into a street light at night gets what they deserve.
That is true.
Yes, the dark sky on the Great Barrier is called a sanctuary. Yet the one that technically is called a zoo.
Correct.
Why is that?
There are differences in those two categories and how they're defined. In particular, the reserve, by definition, is a fairly large area of land that has to be at least 700 square kilometers. So actually, they're much larger than that. They're about 1,700 square kilometers of the county. And it consists of a core that is dark, and nominally that's the Rocky Mount Chuk National Park. And then there is a territory around it that we call a buffer, where you might have settled areas and there's light, but you've worked on creating the conditions where their light is kind of maintained and it's not allowed to grow out of control, and it helps preserve the darkness of the core. The sanctuaries, on the other hand, are generally going to be some of the darkest places really on Earth. And they tend to be not like Great Barrier in that they're very, very remote. They're far from all sources of light. And in terms of the requirement of the program that we ask the people involved to engage in outreach, they generally don't have any form of interpretation or dialogue with the public at the site. So you go to Tekapo, there's lots of public engagement there. We imagined that the sanctuaries would probably be in places where there was very little engagement with the public, and so their outreach would be externally focused. They don't yet have a public to reach out to, in a sense. So that's why we finally settled on the sanctuary as the best fit for Barrier. And of course, when Tekapo was established, we didn't even yet have that as a category. So if they apply now, it might be a different story. So it's in the details of the program. Right?
When I went to the Lake Tekapo in the 70s, 1978, there was nothing in that sort of sense as a astronomy outreach sort of thing. It was actually a American communication center, and the John Orr telescope was there, and that was about it. So, but it was really good then, because I was on a camping tour. And I live in North Bentina. I used to live in Howick. And that was actually had the old street lights, which were a room with a bulb in it, not LED or the other thing, just straight street light. They were actually quite good. There was down to 9th magnitude, because I used to live in Howick, Coffee Bay, and then it gradually moved to about half, which is basically, which I've got a telescope now, 4.5 inch, to that the most, that I can see at Blockhouse Bay, and also at Harrow, the same. So, and I used to come to the observatory here as well, since I used to be a member in 1972.
So you've seen a lot of change during that time?
Yes, true. There has been a lot of changes. And more or less the Auckland City itself, you can only see about one magnitude at the most.
Now we're concerned about impacts at Tekapo because of the growth of the town.
Yeah.
There's more light there than there used to be, and that's one of the sort of philosophical questions that we're asking ourselves right now is, can you grow your astrotourism industry without ultimately killing the goose that lays the golden egg all the time because you bring in hotels and restaurants and they want, tourists want light, they're coming from cities, they want the safety of the experience that they're used to, and so it's a balance. How do we keep the sky dark but also allow for the growth of that industry?
I know, especially the two famous things, the tree, that's in the lake, which is a favorite photographer's and also
it's
church. But on a clear night, if you go there, it's jam-packed with people, so it's sort of, that creates a problem.
It's possible to love your park to death.
There's also certain times of a year when there isn't so much tourism. True, during the winter time there is lots of it. During the summer months there's plenty of it, but during the spring or say autumn or May like this, there's not much tourism going on. That's the best time to go.
One more question to ask, you've got one. Do you want to go first?
Yeah, my question is not really to do with dark sky. I saw you explaining about the blue light and the damage that you do to your eyesight or a lot of unknowns.
Right.
Is there anything you could be doing at home with your own PC monitor and the settings on that would be better for your eyesight?
Yes. Get a piece of software called f.lux.
Yes.
F.lux. You'll find it. It's a little widget that lives in the background on your desktop, and what it does is it knows obviously what time it is, what time of day. It has you confirm your geoposition, so where you're at on Earth. It predicts the time of sunrise and sunset, so it adjusts automatically to the seasons. And in the hour after sunset, it begins changing the color temperature of your display, and it makes it warmer and warmer and warmer. You tell it, I normally go to bed this time of night, and in the last hour that you're awake, it ramps it down even further. It's trying to bring you into a sense of starting to feel sleepy because that blue light is really activating. Really, you know, and so consequently on the morning side, if you were awake before dawn, in that hour before dawn, it will start making your display increasingly blue to wake you up. And I don't know, the research on this is mixed, but I can tell you anecdotally, having used it for about 3 years now, I think that my sleep has improved because I'm one of these people who's terrible about working way too late into the night and staring at the screen. A lot of mobile devices now have an equivalent built into it, or you can get an app that will do it. And I recommend it apart from all of the stuff about light pollution, because truly, having dug into some of this health research, it's worrisome.
Mm.
It's worrisome. And we may think that, you know, exposure to this kind of level of indoor light is not that big of a deal, but it might be.
Okay,
I'm going
to take our last question, Alistair.
Yes, recently on space.com and other venues has been published about Portugal and their tourism categories. Your map shows Portugal looking pretty bright.
Yes.
How do their categories compare with the IDA sanctuaries and reserves?
Well, that area that is working on this for tourism is a region called Alqueva, and they are applying for dark sky reserve status right now. They already have a designation from what's called Starlight Foundation, which is largely European focused on dark skies. There's a region roughly along the border between Spain and Portugal in the southern end of the country that turns out to be incredibly dark, and it's just because, once again, no one lives there. It's a very lightly populated part of the country. So on the Iberian Peninsula, it may be the darkest part of that region. And about 15 years ago, they noticed that and they started developing tourism around it, and it's come up very beautifully. And now they're finally getting around to going through the formal process of certification.
Okay, thanks everyone. Just before we adjourn to supper this evening, I'd like to present John with a small gift of thanks. Thank you for doing this.
Oh, thank you very much.